Here are a few of the saddest stories involving lottery winners. Number 9, Beverly Seltzer. What would you do if you discovered an unsold winning lottery ticket that was worth $4 million? We're not sure if this story is sad, smart, wrong, or a combination of all three, but this was the situation that happened to Beverly Seltzer, and she chose to buy the winning lottery ticket that was just laying around at her workplace. But was she ever the rightful owner? It all started back in March of 2019 when Beverly was working as a cashier at Acme, a grocery store. A customer had walked in and bought $22 worth of lottery tickets. Beverly printed out the tickets with a few numbers on each of the tickets, but the customer wanted each set of numbers printed on its own ticket. So he gave back the tickets and she did what he asked. She set aside the now unsold ticket. Fast forward a few hours later, and Seltzer realized that one of the tickets the man didn't want was a $4.1 million winning ticket. So she went back to Acme and bought the winning ticket. She rang up the sale by selling it to herself for 10 bucks. She brought the ticket to the lottery office and they certified the ticket as a legitimate winning ticket. They then started the entire process for her, just like any other lottery ticket winner. But everyone at Acme, including the corporate office, found out how everything happened because of the review of the security footage. Corporate lawyers for Acme showed up and claimed that the corporation owns all unsold tickets. They also said that she could not be the owner of the ticket herself because of another rule. She had rang up the sale herself instead of having another employee do it. That was a direct violation of company policy. The ticket was held in escrow ever since Acme filed a lawsuit, and in December of 2020, the courts ruled in favor of Acme, not Beverly. Apparently, the judge's ruling depended on how Acme treated all tickets sold by mistake and return. Acme has to pay the lottery commission for every mistake ticket, but they can also keep the winnings from any of those tickets that pays off. Had been doing with all its losing tickets, and that's why the judge ruled in favor of Acme. Number 8, Jim Hayes. The first time Hayes ever robbed a bank, he was 55. Most bank robbers start way earlier in their life, but Jim Hayes wasn't exactly the typical bank robber. He's a bank robber who's won millions of dollars in the lottery. Nearly 20 years before his bank robbing spree, Jim Hayes had won millions in the lottery. But on the day he was busted, Hayes was living in a garage with nothing to his name. Hayes said that having money gave him money to live out his wildest dreams. But he also claimed that he caught the lottery curse. So just what exactly happened? Hayes had a hard life growing up in California. He grew up with his grandmother after his mom wasn't deemed fit to raise him. He never knew his dad. He grew up with minimal education, and he ended up taking on random jobs all his life. But at the age of 35, Lady Luck blessed Hayes, at least financially. He won $19 million in California's Super Lotto jackpot back in 1998. He had been working the graveyard shift as a security guard at that time, and he quickly quit his job. Hayes took home $13.7 million after taxes. He was smart enough to choose the annuity, and there were supposed to be 20 annual payments of $684,000. But even taking the annuity couldn't protect him from his destructive habit. Predictably, he spent his money like it was going to last forever. He bought Lambos and Porsches. He bought million-dollar oceanfront condos. He went on expensive vacations such as Vegas to gamble money away. This was after him telling the press the exact quote of, "I'm not gonna blow the money." But that's exactly what happened. Life caught up with Hayes fast. He had back pain from 3 herniated discs, and he started getting into pills. He got divorced, and his ex-wife was entitled to half the payments. Alimony, bad business decisions, and just his overall spending had creditors coming out for his pending paychecks. Soon, the California lottery began withholding his payouts. Hayes eventually filed for bankruptcy in 2007, just 9 years after winning the lottery. Fast forward 10 years, by 2017, he was basically homeless. And that's when Hayes turned to robbing banks. On his very first bank robbery, Hayes walked right inside and handed the teller a note demanding cash. She handed it right over and Hayes ran out, but not before saying, "Sorry, family emergency." He was in and out of the bank, into his car, with $3,300 cash in less than 3 minutes. Over a period of 5 months in 2017, Hayes hit 10 more banks in Los Angeles and Santa Barbara areas. He was called the PT Cruiser Bandit by local media. That's because he bought a champagne-colored PT Cruiser specifically to use as his getaway car. Being a bank robber was tough work. He stole only roughly $40,000 before FBI agents caught up with him. Taking on that type of risk for only a few thousand dollars each time was something unthinkable to Hayes. It was chump change for him not that long ago. Hayes was convicted and sentenced to 3 years in prison in June of 2018. Number 7. Martin and Kay Tott. Back in March 2001, the Totts were a young couple who were on top of the world. They had just won a £3 million jackpot. Except there was a little problem. They didn't have the ticket. They had lost it, and they only had hours to claim it. The Totts were regular lottery players, and they were always playing the same numbers every single time. It was a combination of personal details such as their birthdays, their ages, when they first met, and the day they got engaged. But the one time they won, forgot to check the numbers. It wasn't until they watched their local news months later. The reporter announced that someone in their area held an unclaimed lottery ticket. The jackpot winner only had hours to claim their prize before the 180-day limit on claims expired. That's when they saw their winning numbers come up on the screen. But where did they put the ticket? They looked everywhere for the ticket, and they never found it. They decided to call lottery officials with their story. The lottery company's security chief, Martin Chalice, told the Tots he was sure that they were the rightful ticket holders on day one of their investigation, but there was another rule. There's a 30-day time limit on reporting lost tickets. Lottery officials knew that their story was genuine, but made them wait almost 7 agonizing weeks to make their official ruling. No payout. The time that the Tots went through before the ruling was already stressful enough, but after hearing the verdict, they were devastated. Apparently, the lottery officials were actually on the Tots' side. They really wanted to give them the money, but they didn't want to open up any can of worms and set any new precedent. They had to abide by its rules and not have any gray areas whatsoever. The reason it took so long to let the Tots know the verdict was because they had referred the case to its legal advisors to see if they could find a way to pay up. When lawyers couldn't find a way, the case was referred to the National Lottery Commission to see if it had any extra discretion to authorize payment. But those officials also decided that they could not override their own 30-day rule. For what it's worth, lottery officials offered free professional counseling to the Tots throughout the decision-making period. They declined. Number 6. David and Angela Dawes. This is a couple who won a Euro Millions jackpot back in 2011. But because they're famous lottery winners, they were most likely targeted. Thieves came into their new luxury mansion and stole their things, all while they were tied up. David and Angela Dawes are originally from Wisbech, Cambridgeshire. They became Britain's 7th biggest lottery winners ever at the time, winning £101 million. One of the first things they did was buy a £4.5 million place in West London. 6 years later, the Dawes moved on to East Sussex, where they settled down in the former mansion of British singer Tom Jones. And that's where the robbery took place in April of 2020. So why did they become targets? Well, they're famous lottery winners, and they moved into a famous house. Definitely not a good combination. The robbers made off with approximately £20,000 in cash. They stole some jewelry, and they were able to steal their Range Rover too. But that was found later, abandoned, and burned, most likely to cover the evidence. After they got robbed, the Dawes installed state-of-the-art surveillance cameras on their property. It goes without saying that they should have already had it installed in the first place. 3 men were arrested following the robbery, but they were released without getting charged since there was a lack of evidence connecting them to anything. Number 5. Isaac Carson Jr. This is easily the most tragic story. Isaac was a barber with 2 kids and an aspiring singer when he won the lottery for $50,000 back in 2018. However, after his win, things quickly went south in a situation where he lost his life. His own cousin, Michael Ward Jr., was accused of setting him up to rob him of his money. The situation took place in the parking lot of a bar in Cleveland in June 2018. Ward and 2 other people were meeting Carson to buy some, some leafy greens. Surveillance footage captured every moment of the meeting. That night, Ward was seen getting out of his car into the front seat of Carson's minivan. Following the transaction, a second person from Ward's car joined them in the back seat of the van. And that's when everything went south. Apparently, the guy with Ward jumped into Carson's minivan. He threw zip ties at Carson and expected Ward to tie Carson's wrist together. but Ward refused and threw the zip ties back. This is the version of the story Ward told to the jury. According to Ward, both he and Carson fought back and a struggle happened. The man pulled out a gun, but despite Carson and Ward's attempt to get control of it, it went off and Carson was hit in the back. But this is where the story gets strange. Second person who had gotten in immediately ran out of the van and ran back to Ward's car. Ward got out of the minivan too. And that's when the unidentified person ran back to Carson's minivan to go after him again. All three suspects, including Ward, drove off and left Carson behind at the parking lot. Somehow, Ward was the only person charged. Cleveland police detectives and prosecutors pointed the finger at him because they knew that Ward had known of Carson's $50,000 lottery win. However, Ward defended himself by explaining that he was a person in the wrong place at the wrong time and that he had no idea about what was going to happen. He simply claimed that he didn't know the two guys with him were going to do that. We're just wondering who those two guys are and why were they even there in the first place? After what took place, why did Ward leave with the guys and why were they never identified? The evidence presented by prosecutors was not enough to convict Ward. Jurors deliberated and acquitted Ward of all counts that were against him in October of 2020. However, Carson's immediate family to this day still believe it was a setup. Investigators never found the gun used and no witnesses ever came forward to talk. Number 4. Richard Zelasco. This is the story of how Richard Zelasco had to share a big lottery win with his ex-wife. Richard won the $80 million Mega Millions jackpot back in July of 2013. After taxes and deductions, the winnings amounted to roughly $38.8 million. His ex-wife, Mary Beth, was awarded around $15 million. He and Mary Beth had filed for divorce in late 2011 after having been separated since 2009. They were married in 2004 and have three kids together. It seems like an open and shut case, but it's not. They had already started the divorce process when he bought the ticket, so anything moving forward doesn't have to be split, right? Not in Michigan, at least. Michigan courts say a marriage isn't over until it's officially over. An arbitrator ruled back in June of 2019 that the ticket was a part of the couple's marital assets. He argued that marital property includes all property acquired from the date of marriage until the date of entry of the divorce decree. That included anything acquired during the separation. The court also pointed out that Richard had bought lottery tickets all throughout their marriage and that those losses throughout the marriage were incurred together. So any winnings should be shared jointly. The court also argued that even though Richard spent $1 to buy the winning ticket, it was most likely marital money. So therefore, the lottery ticket was a joint investment. Should any assets that's acquired after the start of the divorce proceedings be split up? Number 3. Sue Burgess. Here's the good news. This actually is not a story with a sad ending, but we included it because we wanted to show how easily it could have been the other way around. Florida woman Sue Burgess was forced to forfeit her lottery prize after USPS lost her winning ticket in the mail. At first, Sue had won $1,000 in Florida's second chance lottery game. She told the press that winning felt like $1,000,000 because she really needed the money. But there was a little problem for Sue. She couldn't claim her winnings at any of the local lottery offices. They were all closed to the public because of the pandemic. So she followed the state lottery's instructions down to the T and went to the post office to send in her ticket via certified mail. However, the ticket never made it to the lottery office in the 1 week time frame required to claim the money. Lottery officials claim that since they never got the ticket, she could not get the money. Sue's initial prize money went to an alternate winner. Sue's other option was that she could have left her ticket in a Dropbox at a local lottery office, but she felt that certified mail was the safer and more efficient option. Obviously, that was the wrong choice. 6 weeks later, the winning ticket was still missing. USPS apologized to Sue and worked with Florida lottery officials to help her cash out her prize. The Florida Lottery at first had said that they weren't responsible for mistakes made by USPS, but they were willing to make an exception for Burgess and pay out her prize if it ever showed up with a postmark date before the original deadline. Luckily for Sue, lottery officials conducted additional investigations because she contacted local news with her story after USPS could not find the ticket at first. The state lottery figured out that the ticket was indeed with the USPS. Sue was lucky that the ticket was actually found by the post office. Her mistake was going with them in the first place. Number 2, Michael Dawes. Remember David and Angela from earlier? Well, that robbery was just their latest problem. Back in 2017, they had to deal with a problem with someone that was close to them, David's son. They were forced to go to court when David's son, Michael Dawes, sued. Michael claimed that his dad was, quote, ungenerous in spirit after he had cut him out of the will. But David had already given his son a lot of money. And Michael took that money and burned through 1.6 million pounds in just 2 years. According to his stepmom, Michael supposedly burned through the first 1.2 million in just weeks. David had given Michael the money and expected it to last for life. But of course, that didn't happen. He kept going back to his dad for more money. David actually did give him more money, but not without any tension. For him, the last straw was when Michael showed up to his stepmom's birthday without a gift for her. She got tired of it too. She hilariously gave Michael the advice to stop dining at the Ritz and going to McDonald's instead. The judge was probably tired of it too. He ruled that David didn't need to keep bailing out Michael, especially since he had already given him money. The judge felt that Michael was just entitled. He concluded that Michael and his partner just felt that they could go back to David for more money whenever they wanted. Michael eventually demanded 5 million pounds from his dad and, of course, took him to court. Michael and his boyfriend were spending anywhere from around 20,000 to 30,000 pounds a month. They had around 1,000 pound weekly grocery bills, something the judge called an astonishing level of expenditure. Michael argued to the judge that he and his boyfriend had been told by David that the money would keep coming in. And that's why his boyfriend James quit his position as a lieutenant in the Royal Navy, essentially giving up his military career. He said that the money from his dad and stepmom had helped him with his mortgage to buy a BMW and also to help out his own friends and his boyfriend's family. Obviously, this became a he said, she said situation, but really, doesn't his dad always reserve the right to do whatever he wants, even if he did say that to him? Do you think Michael is entitled? Number 1. Sheriff Gurgis. Sheriff Gurgis was just 23 when he won a jackpot of 30 million Australian dollars back in 2007. Unfortunately for Gurgis, he lost it all. But it wasn't in the typical way of spending. And there is a silver lining here for Gurgis. When he first won the lottery, he took on the financial advice of a prominent real estate agent in the area named Russell Palawaka. He advised Gurgis and got him to invest in a bar. Gurgis spent more than $1.3 million on renovations, but when the bar was a losing proposition, it lost $1 million over a 3-year period. Palawaka also convinced him to buy a luxury catamaran called Moonlight Express and run a charter business. This was a money-losing venture as well. He also got Gurgis to buy a nightclub named Crush. This was a disaster too. Gurgis also bought land with waterfront views because Palawaka convinced him to. But the land was grossly overpriced when Gurgis bought it. Palawaka was supposed to be a pro at the very least in real estate, but clearly he wasn't. Eventually, Gurgis realized his mistake in picking a financial advisor and overall business partner. So Gurgis launched legal action in 2014 against Palawaka, the person he trusted with managing his money for some reason. Finally, in 2019, after a lengthy court battle that took over 5 years, Australian court ruled that Palawaka owed Gurgis a little more than $2 million. The long story short is that the court thought Palawaka's representation was both misleading and deceptive. And the lesson here is that choosing someone to take care of money is extremely important. Hire a financial professional and not a real estate professional. Here's what's next.